one of the core values of the Video Freaks to me was their sense of hospitality in their farmhouse up in the Catskills in Greene County. People came from all over to learn about video, and I feel that same energy here at the Sanctuary for Independent Media. I've been fed two meals already today by the people here, and gotten a tour and got to see what you guys are all doing here, and it's just incredibly inspiring. So as Branda said, this exhibition is on view at the Samuel Dorsky Museum of Art at SUNY New Paltz through July 12th. I hope you can come see it. We're doing public programs all over the state. Our next one is going to be in Brooklyn, and we're doing a panel on freaks and feminism. So if you've got folks in Brooklyn, June 18th, please tell them about that. Anyway, this show consists not just of restored videos of the Video Freaks. These are all at the Video Data Bank in Chicago. This is a major distributor of video art that has undertaken the task of preserving these tapes, hundreds and hundreds of them. You can see some of those tapes in the exhibition, along with photography, drawings, historic audiovisual equipment. So now I just wanted to take this opportunity to introduce the Video Freaks, but maybe just a few words about them first. So this collective consisted of 10 core members. They formed in 1969. A few of them met in Woodstock, New York at the festival. Both had early video equipment, and we all have to, this is an important moment to remind everyone that at this time, there were three television commercial networks. This is where we were getting most of our information. Cable was in its infancy. PBS was also in its infancy. There were groups like the Video Freaks who were frustrated that rather than being passive consumers of television, they wanted to make their own television. They were going to make guerrilla television. And the Sony Portapak, one of the first portable video cameras and systems available, became available in the late 60s to groups like the Video Freaks. So I'm going to call up to the stage now three Video Freaks. Bart Friedman. He participated in productions by Ant Farm and TVTV, including seminal videos such as Four More Years, The Eternal Frame, and TVTV Goes to the Super Bowl. His own videos have been exhibited at the Everson Museum of Art in Syracuse, the Jewish Museum, and when I worked at the Jewish Museum, this is when I discovered the Video Freaks. I found this tape called Harold's Bar Mitzvah, which Bart shot. It documented a journey from Lanesville in Greene County all the way to Long Island, where the landlords of the Video Freaks, their grandson had his bar mitzvah, and Bart documented the entire journey. His own videos, after Lanesville, he co-directed Media Bus, a post-production facility in Woodstock, and he is currently a partner in Realizations Media, a company that produces and distributes videos related to behavioral health and addiction recovery. He is a video producer in regional arts and community affairs, serving as a board member of Socrates Public Access Television and Willow Mixed Media. Next up, Perry Teasdale. Served as an advisor to the Federal Communications Commission task force that resulted in the adoption of low-power television service in the United States. Perry's FCC report appended to the final rulemaking was based on Lanesville TV. Thereafter, he co-founded the Television Center, an LPTV consulting firm. And in 1985, he began writing for and then became managing editor of the weekly Woodstock Times. And he is currently owner and publisher of the Columbia Paper and ColumbiaPaper.com. And you can buy his memoir on Amazon, which was a great resource for me when I was preparing this exhibition. And finally, Carol Von Tobel. Did I say that right? No, Von Tobel. Von Tobel worked as an educator and as a caseworker for the developmentally disabled after the dissolution of Lanesville TV. She is currently employed as a licensed social worker, having earned a master's degree from the University at Albany. Her video, A Portapak Conversation, which you can see at SUNY New Paltz, produced collaboratively with David Court and Perry Teasdale, was screened as part of the Women's Video Festival in Buffalo, New York City, and San Francisco. And later, I'm going to introduce another special guest who's going to join us. So Will the video freaks please join me on stage? Who's going to be Bob Dylan? Oh, well, that will be revealed later. Who our secret guest is.
Is there assigned seating?
No. Okay. Just come close. So as I was saying, the Video Freaks initially formed at Woodstock. They were in New York City initially. They formed around this CBS production. It was a pilot presentation called Subject to Change. The Video Freaks were already documenting the counterculture at the time. And CBS also was interested in seeing what was going on with youth movements at the time. A connection was made, and they were hired by a company connected to CBS to start doing work on this pilot presentation, Subject to Change. I'm not going to talk a lot about Subject to Change. We're going to focus more on Lanesville TV. But I think Lanesville TV is essential for any group that's interested in harnessing the power of technology, whether it's a low-power FM station or social media. Lanesville TV is a model for social practice and participatory art today. And I think what's important here is that we're all standing on the shoulders of these folks. I felt that same way with many of the curators before me who were working in early video. We're not here to fetishize this history. We're not here to mythologize, but we're here to learn. This is a living history. Although the Video Freaks aren't active today collectively as a production group, there are individuals like Perry, like Bart, who are still doing journalism, still teaching, and using technology to tell stories and create social change. So what we're going to do is we're going to show three tapes, and we're going to talk in between those tapes. And I hope we'll get into a deeper discussion on some of these questions. What is needed to successfully enlist and empower communities to participate in artist-led projects? Whether it's low-power FM radio or reclaiming land and turning them into gardens. And how does one build respect for audiences? So those are my two main questions. So we're going to show the first tape, which is called Lanesville Overview, and it's one of the first tapes. But maybe we can talk a bit about why you guys left New York and why Lanesville. How did you end up there?
We were looking for a place we could afford to live. And we actually had set up our studio in a loft in a neighborhood of Lower Manhattan. My story is that I was walking one day with some boards to complete the studio or some construction, and a cop stopped me, and he said, "Hey, you know what they call this place?" I said, "No." He said, "Soho." He says, "South of Houston." Imagine that. And I didn't mean anything. I said, "Who cares?" And it was a neighborhood of factories mostly, and little bodegas, and it was really run down, cobblestone streets. And if you saw it today, you'd never know that, because it was slowly beginning its transition into one of the hippest shopping areas of Manhattan, I guess. I don't spend much time there, but it is very different today. And it was becoming way too expensive to live there. And we needed to also find a place to pursue a grant that we'd gotten from the New York State Council on the Arts. And it said specifically that we would bring information about video to groups and individuals throughout New York's upstate New York, because the state council had suddenly come into a lot of money from state government. The Rockefeller administration had found that was a place they wanted to put some money, and film and video were on the list of things to fund.
And Carol, Carol, like at that time, would you say there was a sincere interest among the collective of 10 at the time to do education and training?
I don't know. Certainly, I didn't care about it. I think people wanted to make videos. Mm-hmm. People wanted to make videotapes. And the way to get money to do that was to teach other people, which became fine. I mean, it was fun. There was nothing wrong with doing it, but it wasn't, I don't think, what do you think, Bart, was it? It's what we sold them, and they bought it.
We were certainly taking a leap, because while I was learning how to do video, I was also driving a taxi cab.
Yeah.
So and I was able to pay my rent and spend my afternoons with the video freaks. And at night, I would drive a cab. And
that's where you went.
That's where
we always wondered. Yeah. But it was easy, because nobody knew anything about how to... You know, it was pretty easy to use the machines, and it was no one had any idea how to do it, and everyone was sort of fascinated because they got to see themselves on television. So it wasn't hard. I mean, even though we were still learning, it still wasn't hard.
Well, it wasn't hard because we all had we were all at the same level, and we were all supporting each other. But when I look at the tapes now, I realize that we didn't understand that much about what we were doing.
Oh, no, it wasn't good. I didn't say it was good.
Well, you know, and
but
it's funny because...
It was easy to entice people into doing it, because who saw themselves on TV except maybe in a store window or something? So, and we loved seeing ourselves on TV. I mean, it was fascinating.
I think that's what it was. I think we liked seeing ourselves.
So can you guys describe Lanesville when you first encountered it?
It's an elsewhere area defined by the government.
And what does that mean?
I don't know, but it's pretty insulting.
It's an aeronautical term, and it meant that there was very little flight activity over it, so that they would test jet aircraft from the Navy, and they were flying these jet aircraft that flew off carriers, only they were coming off land to do these tests, and they had these primitive, like Pac-Man computer screens, and there'd be these little, they actually showed us a film about this when they came, because people complained.
And we complained.
But other people complained too, and they came and they did a whole show, but it was one of the things that Lanesville TV did, our prior TV station, was to galvanize public opinion, and one of the public opinion pieces that we did was about these jets that were flying over at treetop
level.
And
didn't they break the sound barrier?
Well, they were awfully
loud.
When a jet flies at treetop area, I mean, I could identify the plane for the government because I could send them a sketch looking down on top of the plane. And that was because if you were on the mountainside, that's where you could see the plane. You could look down on the top and see the pilot.
And they said they did it because it was an elsewhere area.
Elsewhere area. So it was an elsewhere.
So who is living in this elsewhere? Can you describe the people?
No, I shouldn't. I've gotten in trouble in the past.
Bart, can you describe them?
My daughter did not like the way I described them once. I'm not doing it.
Was there a question?
Yes, the question is, describe the people of Lanesville.
Oh, the people in Lanesville were much different. If you were traveling in Europe and met somebody who spoke a little English, it was sort of the same experience when you spoke to people in Lanesville. We were all city people, I guess. Many of us were. Well, you were like a
suburban or city. Different.
And
yeah.
People up there had much less experience than we had. I don't think anybody in Lanesville had ever been in a taxi cab, much less driven one. You know, so it was a level of sophistication that we brought. That may not have been sophistication,
right.
But it was
your worldly taxi cab.
A perfect example is.
But people in Lanesville drove yellow earth-moving equipment, and that's certainly something I never experienced.
The first week we were there, we were sitting on the porch, and the garbage lady drove her dump truck across our front yard, and we all had not seen that before.
How do you remember?
Where we lived, people didn't do that, and we thought, aha. We're really somewhere else.
The post office and the general store was about a mile down the road, and one day we pulled in. I don't know who was in the car, but there were some little kids aged 7 to 9 or 11, and one or two of them picked up some gravel from the from the ground and threw it at us and said, "You dirty hippies." So that was also within the week or two while we were there. So that was our introduction to.
So we'll get into later about the development of a relationship with this community. So I'm going to set up this video now, and then I'm going to ask the freaks to join me down there so we can watch. So this video that we're going to watch, called Lanesville Overview, was shot on March 22nd, 1972, and it's one of the first Lanesville TV broadcasts documented in progress. So Carol and her fellow freak, Nancy Kane.
Did you say broadcast?
Sorry, microcast, right? Is that a better term to use?
Did you say anything about there being a TV station?
About Lanesville TV?
Yeah, but broadcast and antenna and reaching all the people in Lanesville.
Well, I haven't gotten into that, but maybe we can talk about that after after the video. So we're not going to see this portion of the tape because I'm moving 10 minutes ahead into it, but the tape begins actually with Carol and her fellow freak, Nancy Kane, sitting at Doyle's Bar, the local hangout, and talking to residents about the uses of this new TV station. And one of them says, "We still feel it's for everybody. It's not just for us." A resident pitches ideas, including a swap program, kind of like a Craigslist, for TV. And then we're going to get a glimpse of the inner workings of an actual broadcast at Maple Tree Farm, which is the farmhouse that they rented. You'll see some technical challenges and some viewer feedback. Let's take a look.
Lanesville TV is back on the air, as we said on Sunday, and tonight we have another tape of Lanesville that we shot today, and Nancy, you shot it, you have anything to say about it, where you went, and what you did?
Well, I think that it'll be pretty clear what's happening, as we're in there, everybody knows, and this tape shows
which one is broadcast?
This is the broadcast room here. This is the video, and this is the cameras and the output of the SVG, the camera there. Mm-hmm. And that's the audio level. And this is the tape playing right here. This is the tape that's on right now. That machine will go on after we go live, after this tape. And then this is another tape on.
So,
D. See.
Haven't seen that. I've never seen that tape.
No, I've never seen that footage.
Have you seen it?
Everybody should be away this far.
Huh?
It's good thing.
Everybody should be this far away.
Okay.
It's that one styling.
So,
you can do it every once.
We talked about the use of the telephone and lateral TV.
It was essential from the beginning that we have a way to get feedback from the audience so that we knew what was going on with them, because we didn't know who was going to be watching. As you got a little taste of some of the children from the neighborhood who walked in the door. That was a surprise, I think. I don't think anybody expected them to just to drop over like that, the Benjamin boys who walked in. But the phone was our way of connecting with people and allowing them to feel that they were part of what we were doing. And the phone number was up throughout the program, and the phone was live. Whenever we were live, the phone was live. Usually not during tape, it wasn't connected, or you weren't listening. It was connected, but it wasn't being broadcast. But people's voices were being broadcast, and they weren't being time delayed. We didn't even have a way to do that. And we didn't want to anyway. We wanted to hear from people. And I think maybe once or twice in all those years, maybe somebody tried to say something that would have gotten us in trouble with the FCC if the FCC had known anything about us, which it didn't. And so it was an integral part of the program and always was. And sometimes it went so far as to have people say, you're interfering with my program, and I want you to fix it or turn it off. And we said, well, if nobody's going to say keep it on, then we'll turn off this program.
Our signal was kind of rowdy. Yeah. It wasn't controlled like a professional broadcast signal.
No.
Our signal was just like all over the valley there. And so occasionally people will watch what were there.
Except where their antennas were sometimes.
But remember, people didn't have much TV in Lanesville. They got it from Wilkes-Barre Scranton. And
they
get better?
Well, basically the television in that very deep valley, and that's what it was, a very deep valley with a stream that kind of cut all the way down to the village of Phoenicia or Hamlet there. And anyway, they watched TV that came in over the mountain from Hartford, from Utica, from Albany, and from Scranton Wilkes-Barre. We were actually the people, I think, who found you could get Scranton Wilkes-Barre TV stations. And that's how we watched. And usually not very much of any TV at all, because it was so isolated and so deep in the mountains, and there wasn't any cable.
Which was lucky for us. I mean, that's part of why it worked. If they'd gotten a lot of nice New York stations, they would have hated.
Right.
And speaking of the phone, there were occasions too when we called up our audience to find out if they were watching or to remind them to watch.
And sometimes they wouldn't tell the truth, but then you'd find out from a comment that someone made later that they had been watching. It was something about Sarah, wasn't it? Someone made a comment and we knew, oh, you're watching, but you'd never admit that, a certain person who wouldn't admit they were watching, but they were. It was fun. It was fun.
It was irresistible. I mean,
put
their kids on.
Yeah, it was irresistible.
They came on with their recipes and did cooking shows, and everybody wanted, a secret recipe or family recipe was really an important thing. If you can get it out of somebody, people did
so
that.
So maybe this is a good segue to set up the next video. You know, the one we just saw was one of the first broadcasts, and now we're going to see one from 1975 called The Sheik Who Shook Lanesville. Some of the context for this is that between 1973 and 1974, Arab oil producers were cutting off exports to the U.S. to protest the American military support for Israel during its war with Egypt and Syria. This brought up soaring gas prices, long lines at filling stations, some of you remember this, and it contributed to a major economic downturn in the U.S. and affected everybody. And Saudi Arabia symbolized the wealthy Arab monarchies, and Americans felt economically threatened. Now we're going to take a look at the Sheik Who Shook Lanesville. So yes, one question here.
That was one of your earlier videos that you had made. I noticed in your shelves that you had tons and tons of footage of videos, and I was just wondering.
Because we shot everything that moved. We went to fairs, we went to fairs where people were doing crafts, we shot everything, and we shot all the time. So we had hundreds of tapes when we moved to Lanesville.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. I mean, we just really, there were nine of us, and we were shooting all the time.
And we had been in New York City shooting all the time, so we brought all the tapes up.
Branda wants me to remind everyone, if you do have questions in the future, please go to the microphone that's over here that up. Let's watch The Sheik Who Shook Lanesville.
I wanted to talk for about a half hour about that tape we just saw.
You can't.
No.
I have a question while you're moving. How big is Lanesville? How many people? What's the audience?
Summer community, but also a lot of people who worked in logging and silviculture and had jobs out of the area, like driving trucks, and came back. It had no commercial activity really, except for the bar and the general store and the post office. And the general store and the post office were one, and there was a second bar that was there for a short time, and that was it.
sheep of the sand, the sun, the heat. Perhaps I find some place exotic far away. Bring me the herd. Bring me some rock.
Ah, Your Majesty. How are you today?
I'm well, thank you. And Your Majesty?
What have you to report to me?
Your Majesty, I have a list of places which you might be interested in buying.
I hope you have made some good selections for me, Colonel.
Well, we have an exceptionally good deal on Duluth.
Duluth? Duluth. I think it's Duluth in Duluth. Not for me, no.
Would you like San Diego, perhaps?
San Diego, the airport is much too small.
How about Dallas?
Dallas, I could not build a palace in Dallas, no.
Well, I have one other place. No, I don't think Your Majesty would like it.
Tell me everything. I consider the
old Lanesville.
Lanesville? You mean Lanesville?
Is it the Catskill Mountains
of Catskill Mountains? You mean the Borscht Mountains? Well, yes, I know. These lakes, mountains, greens. I love it.
Take me there right away if you are a plane, Gordon. Then we go?
We go.
We leave within the hour.
This here is potentially very, very valuable property for himself to restore potential. The story of knowing the mineral resources are by which can be exploited at a reasonable dollar investment. Back home on his mountains in the desert, he can be the spot I can
into a vast vacation community in this part of the Catskills. This is Carol Montobel, Lanesville TV, Channel 3.
Sheikh Ibn Barkhouf.
Yeah, it's awesome.
Yeah, he will give you
about $5,000?
No, please give this man some $50.
How much dollars would you care for?
$66,000.
$66,000. I think I might have it in my pocket.
Here's the bottle.
$1,000.
smile down on you to buy land, he sometimes does not smile in your valley.
Well, I'm reminded what you said before when you first arrived in Lanesville in 1971, and people were throwing gravel at you and calling you dirty, long-haired hippies. And we get to this point in 1975 when you're getting full participation from the community. So I want to ask you guys how you got from there, from the rock throwing, to the Shiku Shook Lanesville. What was necessary to connect with that community?
I think we had to be entertaining to them. I mean, there was nothing happening in Lanesville. Nothing. I know, really.
Well,
I mean,
was
it was.
There was a square dance, remember?
There was a square dance?
Yeah, at the second bar.
And there were roast beef dinners. But they're really, I think they just got interested. And the thing that's interesting about this is people didn't know that we were going to do this. They spontaneously acted. That's what I thought. And they could all act. That was kind of amazing. There were several of these, and nobody knew.
In 1971, anybody with a port-a-pack, the ability to make a video and show it
back in
the camera or on a TV set, was a novelty because we all had been raised on television, but no one ever thought that we would be in control of it at some point.
That's true.
I think anywhere we might have landed, I mean, even in New York City.
And the kids came first.
No.
The kids came around first, and then their parents came around.
But we pursued them, too. I mean, we went to the Rod and Gun Club, stocking of
the
stream.
Dinner,
we went
yeah.
to church events, things
and
like that.
And we did a show that was like, remember Person to Person, Edward R. Murrow? We did that show. We went into people's houses. It wasn't exactly like that. And one woman thought we were going into her house to case the place to come back and rob stuff. And I thought, she didn't have anything I wanted. You know, what was she thinking? But I didn't say it to her.
And other people thought that we were sexual deviants, drug addicts, hippies, leftist, whatever politics.
A few people who came to visit who liked to walk around naked, and that really was fascinating to the children.
Mostly
the Germans.
I have a question here.
That's right.
So we see examples like in the Shiku Shook Lanesville of Lanesville residents participating as performers. Was anyone ever trained to actually run a broadcast?
From Lanesville?
Yeah.
Oh.
No, I don't think so. Uh-huh. I don't recall anybody, but they certainly were welcome to participate in whatever form they wanted. No one expressed an interest particularly, and we weren't out recruiting specifically for them to do it, but there was no barrier. Had any of the kids expressed an interest in the technological side. I think,
but they didn't, did they? I mean, no one ever shot a tape either.
No,
really.
No one ever. But they were constantly participating as performers and as news deliverers and things like that. But I think in answer to your first question, part of it is trust and part of it is respect. We were not there to goof on these people. We were not there to treat them as subjects. We were there because we were living there and we wanted to share what we were doing with them, and we were genuinely engaged in that, and we wanted to pursue it, and we were willing to compromise and willing to have fun. And because of that, and because they knew what would happen with it, and that we weren't, that we would have to answer to them if we did something really bad in terms of their images and their presentation, they were willing to play along with that, because The Shake Who Shook Lanesville was improvisational from beginning to end. It was just an idea that came up, and I said, let's do this, and I talked to Bart about it and talked to everybody, and you saw a lot of people involved in the Video Freaks in it in various different ways. And then we also got our neighbor who had that Cadillac. You know, who knew somebody had a Cadillac in Lanesville? And here he was willing to share with us and to be part of that show. But those other folks who were playing parts, clearly they're not professional actors, but they were into it. They did not give us a hard time, and they didn't react, no, don't do me. I can't recall any, maybe I'm glossing over a few people, but generally the whole reception was, hey, yeah, sure, okay, do that. It's not going to take long, it's not going to hurt.
I think it's true that we genuinely liked people in Lanesville. I mean, really, we were friends. When Sarah was born, somebody gave me a baby. Gave me a baby carriage, you know, and that was her baby carriage. Someone in town gave us one, and people gave us clothes. I mean, we really did, and we liked the kids. The kids were fantastic. And we had people over for dinner, and they had us over for dinner.
And we dressed up for our parts. We, Perry, I don't know where you got that Easter Bunny costume.
Well, it was actually one that Nancy had developed with Anne a year before. Because Nancy had been interviewed, talked about person to person, I think Carol interviewed Nancy as the Easter Bunny one year on the program, just a kind of a very casual interview with a celebrity. And then the next year, I decided
Nancy
to create.
Nancy couldn't remember where she left her eggs. Right?
Is that what it was? No, I think there was a whole big thing, and then the kids came over with their Easter baskets.
Because the chickens stopped laying eggs.
The chickens stopped laying eggs,
and it was a crisis. So we had to go from house to house asking people for eggs.
And these were all set up. We had the setup for people, and they were very easy for people to understand.
They gave us eggs.
So you'd say to people, the chickens won't lay eggs. They're on strike. What should we do for Easter? And then they would come up with answers. I can't remember what they are, but they were pretty crazy. And then the plots became, at a certain point, more elaborate, but they were still improvised. And if they would not have worked if it hadn't been for the genuine responses of the people in Lanesville who were playing along, to the degree that it may be politically incorrect and culturally insensitive, but you can get a laugh out of it because you know the people were having a good time doing it. And it wasn't. Well, whatever. Whatever it was or wasn't, it was certainly fun to do, and certainly the people of Lanesville seemed to like it because we didn't get negative feedback
and
about it.
There were some bad things that happened. There was someone who got shot, a young boy who got shot, and immediately we went to a meeting to talk about what happened, and we were really part of the community after
and
that.
And we broadcast it. The fact that this was an issue because Lanesville was in another area code, was in the Ulster County area code, and you may have to make a long distance phone call to get the fire company and things like that. And people wanted certain services, and they found out that it wasn't just about getting rid of the hippies in town, it was about the fact that they had been disenfranchised. And when they went to the town board and we videotaped it and then we broadcast it, they got a deputy or a police officer who would patrol Lanesville. They got a stop sign. They got a local telephone number that they could call without making a long distance call. And they were amazed because suddenly they had power. television had brought them power over their own lives. It wasn't.
And we had brought them the television.
And we had brought them the television. So we were able to facilitate that communication, and it was a very rewarding thing because it started out very negative. It was all about getting rid of the hippies, and then when it came down, but what do we really need? Mm-hmm. And then they found they could get something, that's where the elsewhere area came in.
I want to take this opportunity now to bring up a colleague of yours who also harnessed the power of television. She's here in the audience. Dee Dee Halleck is going to join us on the stage. So I'll tell you a bit about Dee Dee. So Dee Dee is a Video Freaks groupie. She is a media activist and co-founder of Paper Tiger Television and the Deep Dish Satellite Network, the first grassroots community television network. She is Professor Emerita in the Department of Communication at the University of California at San Diego. Her film, Mural on Our Street, was nominated for an Academy Award in 1965, and she has led media workshops with elementary school children, reform school youth, and migrant workers. And Dee Dee collaborated on several projects with the Video Freaks, and she was a frequent visitor to Maple Tree Farm. Welcome, Dee Dee.
Thank you.
So, Dee Dee, can you tell us how you got to know the Video Freaks?
Well, first, I just want to make sure everybody knows that Bart was the sheik. Somebody may have. And Perry was his assistant.
Colonel.
Which, they were such good actors. They were...
You didn't recognize me.
I was doing a project in Middletown, New York, called Live Arts, and we were doing happenings and video films. I didn't have a video camera at that time, but 16 millimeter film, and I was applying for a New York State Council on the Arts grant, and they said, you know, you should really go visit these people. They're not that far from you up the road. So I drove up to Lanesville, and I fell totally in love. I was sort of stuck in a painful monogamous relationship with three children that were, and I was by myself most of the week because my then husband was away during the week at music school, and the fact that someone could live together and share all the experiences was so inspiring to me, and that they would have help with the children. I mean, I remember Annie and Chuck feeding Sarah, and the notion that you could have a baby and it wasn't just like this monogamous couple, you know, that, and it just was always so much fun. So I used to bring my kids up there, and my son Toby learned to fish from Davidson, and it seemed like the ideal way to live, for one thing. And in terms of the video, the way people engage was something I was trying to do in Middletown, but not at all that successfully. And I feel that that the respect that they did have for the neighbors was very touching. And the way people played along, like no one's mentioned, Bart did this program called Buckaroo Bart with this little kid, one of the Benjamin boys, Sheriff John, and I love, and that was like a weekly show, or maybe.
But was that that was scripted, wasn't it? A little bit scripted.
It was scripted, like The Shake.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But what was really lovely was that it was using a television convention, and in a way, making a comment on that convention, because this was the days of Hopalong Cassidy and all these TV. There were only three channels, as someone mentioned, and there were a lot of them had cowboy shows. And here you could see that a kid could be a cowboy, and he could be the sheriff. And it was empowering, not just for the kid and Bart, But it was empowering for the people who watched it to realize that
you could make your own TV.
Yeah, cowboys could be you.
Yeah.
So.
And Didi, my question for you is, what is connecting the video freaks to today's media makers?
Well, for one thing, Paper Tiger TV, which was a show that started in 1981, was very much influenced by the video freaks. And the other thing I want to say is that what was really interesting to me was that each video freak had sort of their own style and their own
Didi,
interest.
You're not being videotaped by the Paper Tiger TV cardboard camera.
And they were, so it reminded me, I was very much taken by a dance group called Image Union, which was a group of individual dancers, Yvonne Rainer, Steve Paxton, Barbara Dilley, a number of people, and they maintained their own individual style and yet were able, when they came together in what they called the Grand Union, it went somewhere else, but everyone still maintained their own individual way of being. And it seemed to me that was also happening in Lanesville. And so when Paper Tiger started, I felt that's the way it should be, it shouldn't be like everyone has to do the same thing, that it would be a collective of individuals who could, would help each other how to do things, but that they would still maintain their own autonomous art potential. And sometimes it happened. I mean, I don't think it always happened, but when I go down to, like, I spent some time at Occupy, and I taped actually a meeting of the arts and culture group. And I must say it was very contentious, and people always only wanted to do one thing. Like, they had a kind of, well, we should do this, and they wanted consensus, and it didn't have that kind of ability to have within it many voices. And I still think that's what's one of the things that I think a lot of artists and activists and video makers and people really want to express themselves. Obviously, look at YouTube, how many billions of things are posted there every day. But how do people somehow come together to maintain their own individuality, but at the same time do something that has social relevance, you know? And
your comments, Didi, were reminding me of, I think the strength of the video freaks was the diversity of skill sets that they all had.
Yeah.
The fact that, you know, Davidson, for example, was an excellent woodworker and carpenter. The fact that David Court came from a theater background, that folks came from education and business, and all these skills were all brought together. Do you guys want to chime in on anything here?
I could raise my right eyebrow and then my left eyebrow, and I was an actor. And I knew, when I saw myself do that in the mirror, I knew I had to be on camera.
You played a very good cheek. So maybe this is an opportunity now to screen our last video, and then we can open it up for discussion. We're going to show a tape by Nancy Kane called Harriet. That Old Chestnut. This became a feminist classic during the mid-70s. It's Nancy Kane's portrait of her neighbor, Harriet Benjamin, a working-class homemaker who was raising 5 kids with her husband, Bobby, in a trailer near the Lanesville post office. So let's have a look.
Didn't she then run for the school board?
Harriet, I don't think so.
I think somebody told me that.
Possibly.
Yeah.
After our time.
Yeah. She was Sheriff Johnson.
Thank you.
guys talked before about the entertainment value of Lanesville TV programs, and that certainly has it, but what really strikes me with that video, how sophisticated it is in terms of editing. Yeah. The flash forwards, the flashbacks. Bart, you described Harriet as docu-fantasy. This was actually in a transcript of an interview that Dee Dee did with you. You know, it's almost as if Harriet is having some kind of catharsis as she's driving. And actually, Nancy wrote in her memoir, Video Days, quote, at a certain point, I begin to wonder if this is for real. It takes Harriet 5 miles to stop laughing. Maybe you guys can talk about some of the background with Harriet. And unfortunately, Nancy couldn't join us via Skype, but I'd like for you guys to talk about that a bit.
It was a signature tape of the, I think, that era, and certainly one of Nancy's finest works that I'm aware of. And it got attention then and still gets attention. It's pretty straightforward in many ways, but you know the subtleties are there. And in, I remember when it first played and people really reacted much the way people reacted here. They really loved it.
Nancy was an artist. I don't think many of us really knew what kind of talents we had. You know, we lived in this little valley, and some of us, you know, occasionally would bloom. Then we'd unbloom, and then.
It was a little competitive. I mean, I never would have made a videotape, but I had to.
And it's a very good one. It's called A Port-a-Pack Conversation, and it's on view.
Oh, I made a lot of videotapes, many, but I mean, I wouldn't have except that you had to, you know. It was competitive. It was definitely competitive.
We were 10 people, and we all did video. It wasn't like a commune where, you know, somebody did a garden and somebody did something else. Yeah. We all came up from New York City with this one intent to make videos. And some of us, you know, just a natural kind of way, kind of a pecking order, I guess. Some of us did more support work, and other people did more business and more direction, more writing. More.
We all did editing, too. Editing wasn't so hard. I thought it was really fun.
You thought it was fun?
Yeah.
Well, if you've been doing it as many years as I've been doing
it. No, I stopped doing it long ago. It was,
you should, describe the technique of editing reel-to-reel tape.
Is that how I did it?
Yeah, and well, it was simply, it was more about your facility with a stopwatch and your dexterity in pushing buttons and your willingness to put up with crunched tape and destroyed work over and over and over again. It was masochistic, I think, in a very real sense.
In those days, if you watch a lot of tapes that we made in the 70s, you'll watch like a half hour video if you could, where there would be 6 or 7 edits. Nowadays, people watch television and there's an edit every 2 seconds.
Yeah.
And we couldn't do that in those days because we had an original reel and a take-up reel that was recording. We had to find the spot, backwind 10 seconds, run the stopwatch, run both machines at the same time, and push the edit button when you got to your spot. So if you decided 20 minutes into a half-hour program that you didn't like the edit you made at 3 minutes, you had to go back to the third minute and reassemble everything you'd done to catch up to where you just left off.
Yeah, fun.
So mostly you just watched life unfold. There was nothing like that. So that was a sophisticated edit for us. You know, we didn't do that much editing in terms of cut, cut, cut. You know, it never looked like that. It was a different time.
It was a time where there were other films about women rebelling. I went to a screening, Women Make Movies, that started right about that time, and Sheila Page and Ariel Doherty, and they showed these two films, and they basically had exactly the same plot of a woman going to a park with her kid and her kid screaming and driving her nuts, and her fantasies of running off and becoming an artist or whatever. It was a way of expressing the rising consciousness of the needs for women's rights.
Do you guys have questions? If you do, can you please line up over there with the microphone so we can pick that up?
That seems so.
Should we sit on the edge of the
yeah,
stage?
I mean,
or maybe
sort of,
you won't have the right lighting there. Oh.
Should have.
Yeah, we have light in there.
Okay.
I went to as you notice in the credits of that tape, Harriet, the family's name was Benjamin, and there was a lot of them.
That's right, you saw them.
Last summer I went to a Benjamin family reunion picnic up in Shandaken. There was a little park up there, and they invited me. And they're all there, all those little kids. They're all big, at least 250 pounds, the lightest one.
Yeah.
And they invited me in, and they said, have a hot dog. And it was stuffed with cheese. The hot dog was stuffed with cheese. And one of them was shucking clams. And the Neils were there. And it was a fantastic thing. And they were very sweet. And John, one of the boys, he was about seven or eight in Nancy's video, was there. And he left Lanesville, and he went to Binghamton, became a truck driver, and he was married, and now he had a girlfriend, and he kind of got away, and he's quite a guy. I'll tell you about what he told me later. Mm-hmm. But
we have a question over here.
Yeah, I was wondering how making the film affected Harriet's life.
I think it affected her life.
Well, Nancy paid her. Nancy got a grant to do that from the state council, and she gave Harriet part of the grant. And that was, you know, Harriet really appreciated it. But I don't.
Were you there? I've seen the tape of it, I believe, or maybe I'm imagining it, but certainly there was a festival of women's video and film. Susan
Milano.
Milano.
And I believe it was there, or perhaps
Nancy took Harriet to
that? I believe it was to that, although I maybe have those things conflated. And Harriet received a standing ovation from a New York City crowd.
Yeah.
And I think, I don't know how it changed her life. I can't speak for her, and I won't. But I can simply say, for those of us who knew Harriet, it was a wonderful moment, because she got recognition that she might not otherwise have had, and Nancy got certainly the recognition as well. But there was something complete about that moment when she was able to stand up in front of a group of very sophisticated artists in New York and cultured people and receive their applause that was quite genuine.
Harriet was kind of special. Harriet was our best friend in Lanesville, for sure. And she, except for our landlord, and she had a presence. She had had a terrible life. I mean, she'd grown up in foster homes, and her husband was kind of abusive. I mean, she really had a hard life. And she also had some illnesses. But she had a strength and a kind of a vitality and a confidence in herself. It's how she could be in the, you know, how she became our best friend and how she became the star of the documentary, because she had a lot of presence.
Yeah, so she stayed with her husband and she continued raising her family?
Yeah, oh yeah. Oh, yeah. She wasn't really going anywhere. No, she was very devoted to her children. I think she has passed away. She had an illness.
Gone.
Yeah. She had a chronic illness, and she stayed. Because her childhood had been so horrible, she really valued family life. And her husband was, she said he was abusive, but he was also kind of guileless, kind of, I don't know how to explain it. He wasn't a mean person exactly. She stayed, and she, you know, her father-in-law lived across the street, and she took care of him too. So she had a place. She had a very important place right there. Yeah. Might not have looked attractive to anyone else, but it meant something to her. Mm-hmm. And she laughed a lot.
Yeah.
I mean, I remembered that when I watched this again. She laughed all the time. Mm-hmm. And she cooked for us, and she's the one who gave me the baby carriage and clothes for my little daughter. And I think it probably meant a lot to her, and it probably was hard for her when we all left Lanesville. But it was, you know, it's a memory, I'm sure. There was something that happened that was odd. Perry wrote a book and about our experiences in Lanesville, and one of the people in Lanesville, I think it was Harriet's husband, thought he should get some money because he appeared in the book.
There's another question. Yes.
Hello. Hi, my name's Joe. In the mid-70s, I was in high school outside of Springfield, Massachusetts. And in our high school, we had a video production program. It was quite innovative at the time. You know, it started in probably 74, 75. So I learned on that equipment. I learned on black and white, reel-to-reel, port-a-packs. And I guess it's just cathartic to find someone else who actually worked on an equipment to understand what it was like to edit a program on that, because you rewound it and to get the edit right, and it was always, the skew was always off and the things rolling edits was crazy. What I'm interested in though, and even though now we look back at that equipment was somewhat crude, of course, in today's technology, it wasn't cheap. I mean, I remember port-a-packs being $7,000-$8,000, right?
No.
I just was wondering, though, how you afforded, how you supported this. Did you have grants? How did you buy this equipment? And how did you guys continue to buy production equipment and stuff like that?
We started out, David and I had some equipment of our own. It wasn't very good. It was the original port-a-packs couldn't even play back. You had to actually remove the tapes from the portable recorder and place them on a studio type machine, a desktop machine.
You had to rewind.
And you had to rewind by hand if you were doing it from the little machine. I think you asked about the money, and basically we started with that. We also connected, as Andy said in the beginning, very early on with a guy at CBS who wanted to do a program, and he funneled a lot of old CBS, what you might call junk or historic stuff, just stuff that was lying around. They had the microphones the size of pineapples and things like that you can see from radio. And so we got a lot of that equipment, and we got a little bit of money, but basically we used our own finances. I think a port-a-pack, when the new ones came out, they were something like $1,500.
Yes.
Now that
yes.
is in 1970 dollars. So that might be $8,000 today.
But we were funded by the State Council on the Arts.
Well, that came later, actually.
Not much
but
later.
We did some. We did use some of the grant money to buy equipment. We also accumulated along the way various equipment that individuals in the group contributed money that they had, or we would guarantee loans or something like that. We didn't have a lot of money, but we had enough to get it going. And we also spent it, I think, reasonably wisely. We lived on very little. We shared shared apartments, and we shared the food and everything else in order to put the money into what we were doing. And therefore, we ended up spending money early on editing equipment, on real editing equipment, a one-inch videotape recorder. It was a much bigger machine, much more sophisticated, much more frustrating, but it allowed us to do quality work that other people weren't able to do any other way.
We also got jobs.
And we
Carrie wrote a book that made some money. We wrote the Spaghetti City video manual. And we got jobs. We got paid to do.
Yeah, and
to do
were,
like
and
the, oh, well, remember we got paid once in goods from Randall's Island.
Right.
Spaghetti. We got paid in spaghetti.
Green coffee beans, a few thousand ballpoint pens, and 100 cartons of Chesterfield cigarettes.
That's right.
That turned out that.
But we got paid.
Well, we smoked them anyhow.
We got paid.
And so there were things like that. So
yeah, there were jobs.
Different ways.
Yeah.
Improvisation, I think.
But remember, didn't we get a loan from a family, from Davidson's family?
Yeah.
For the IBC?
Our families lent us money.
Yeah. My name is John, and I was fascinated by the conversation about you developing a relationship with the town and how that evolved. And while you were discussing it, it struck me that there was a similarity between your work and the work of the Sanctuary of the Independent Media, how they came to a struggling neighborhood and created a multicultural center for television, now radio, and the arts, and developed a relationship with the neighborhood here, which has benefited the immediate neighborhood quite amazingly, and also the larger community of the Capital District. So my question in relationship to this development is actually just a little bit more directed to Steve or Branda, if I might. And was your experience in developing the relationship with the community here similar to, different but similar to the Video Freaks developing their relationship with their community?
Wow, that's an awesome question, John. Thank you. I think there's probably a parallel, right? I mean, I think if you bring it up, I mean, the whole relationship of trust and respect probably is at the core. And it's true that, especially if you're in a community like in a valley, you know, where there's little information coming in or going out, to use technology is to offer a voice to that community that they didn't have before. And so probably that is a principle that stays the same. I mean, it's an interesting question. Steve, do you have any responses that are different? Or Kathy, do you want to switch with me? Yeah? So, I mean, it's interesting. But, I mean, it's complicated too, though, right? I mean,
you guys probably did it on purpose, though. We did it by accident.
Well, that's interesting.
We didn't move to Lanesville to develop the community.
Right. And what's interesting is that we did not move here to develop to do that either. So actually, that's a parallel, too.
Interesting.
You know, we actually, is Brandon in the audience? No, there was somebody who I thought was in the audience who was a student interning here, like in our first year of 10 years, who wrote a critique of us, that we had moved here and we weren't connecting with the community. And that, like, really got to us, you know? And you know, each year we went further with the community, but it was when we started creating truly collaborative, respectful tapes with the community that the trust started developing. Mm-hmm. And also when we started gardening in the community, you mm-hmm. know, amazing connections through gardening.
Just let me interrupt in the garden, because we had a garden. Annie did it mostly, but with a lot of help from other people. And then Annie and Chuck went on vacation. They're not supposed to tell this story. But basically, there was just at harvest time. And so there's all this bounty from the garden. And so we went on Lanesville TV and we said, we have too much stuff. Come and get it. And it all disappeared.
Wow. That's not what Annie had in mind.
Not what Annie had in mind to do with it, but it was a fascinating test because people heard about
it. That's right.
And they showed up and they just drove up the driveway and they took the vegetables and they went and they were perfectly comfortable doing it. And they wouldn't have known about it. They wouldn't have done anything about it. And so
they wouldn't have admitted they watched Plainsville TV.
And they, you know, those are the other people who came up the driveway with the FBI agents who were spying on us. So
right.
But, you know,
I'm glad you wrote your book when you did, because your memory soul was Harry, he was a historian of Video Freaks, and I would have forgotten many of the stories he remembers, and I'm sure he remembers because he wrote about them. But I'm glad you did that.
I remember a story that really, I think it was the first time I'd ever seen a live show on Lanesville, that they were doing not much of anything, sitting around taking phone calls, and somebody called and said they had a card trick that they wanted to show. And they said, oh, you want to come do it on the air? And they said, yeah. And so the camera went outside to the driveway and watched while the car drove up. And this guy got out and he had a pack of cards, and then they set him down, and he sat there and did this really kind of like a card trick he would do in a bar or something, but it was a really nice close-up, and he was so happy, and somebody called in and said, I saw what you did, you know, play it back, do it again, and it was this really amazing, spontaneous thing that you and probably don't remember.
And save the night, no, yes. I don't remember.
Brenda, you had a follow-up question?
Well, I wanted to say that it isn't in a vacuum that what we were doing here has parallels with what you did, because it really is a continuum, historically, of the early work you did. And if you cut to 10 years later from what you were doing, that's when I met Dee Dee Hallock. And I was doing what I called youth empowerment media workshops. I invented the word because there was no history, there was no framework, there was, you know, I mean, you were just kind of on your own. And Dee Dee, you know, I was working with young kids at Henry Street Settlement.
Where I had worked in 1962.
Right, with your three kids in a triple baby carriage while she was doing media with people, you know, in the Lower East Side. You know, and I mean, so I connected to the history, right? And it empowered me. I mean, it really was, you know, standing on your shoulders and on the history.
And I'm standing on you guys.
Yeah. And actually, I remember I was working with kids, you know, it was all teenage moms, you know, in the middle of New York City, and they were all doing their own piece, and I was just so inspired. And Dee Dee said, oh, well, you got to come out to Willow, which is near Lanesboro, right? Lanesburg, and we all came out to Willow, kids who had never left the city before, and Dee Dee baked us pies, and it was just incredible. She videotaped people, and so, I mean, I think that we're all building on each other's history, and that, but we don't have the framework for it. That's why, Andrew, it's great that you created this show, because it really helps us, you know, for the generations they're following. And that's my question. It's a perfect segue. As an editor, it's a perfect segue. So, and my question is, in a way, you guys came out of, you know, Woodstock and this, like, radical, you know, fissure in, you know, like, kind of mainstream culture. And there really were only three, there was this, you know, three channels on TV, and you're in this new, pure territory for radical creative action. And if you look at people now, who the younger generations who are trying to create radical media or creative media or like to do something different, you know, we're in this information age where we're barraged by, you know, just so much that it's hard to have that kind of pure space to operate in that you guys, in a way, had. You know, and so what is your wisdom? What are your words of wisdom to our generations, our younger generations who are media makers? What can they take from what you learned? You know, what is the same, what is different? And what kind of creative strategies and also kind of protective strategies, you know, of resistance can people take from, you know, your advice?
I think is one thing is, and somebody said it, you said it, or Andy said it, or not mythologizing, we never made any money at it. Yeah. Mm-hmm. If you are in the business to make money, that's fine. There are ways to do that, whether it's video, whether it's new technologies. Do it, but do it with that in mind, and don't expect the experimental stuff, the really fun stuff in a lot of cases, although certainly you can have fun making money and making Hollywood movies, whatever. But don't expect that it's going to yield profits or even a way of living. I think you start with different expectations, that you have to pursue what you want to do and figure it out, but not burden it with thinking that it has to make you a living. Unfortunately, it didn't, for some of us, and fortunately did for others, turn into something like that. But I think that to expect that, oh, you know, we have led comfortable lives after doing this fun stuff is a myth. That's a myth. And I wouldn't want to perpetrate that myth on anybody. It's been difficult at times to leverage what we did then, this whole thing, what you're seeing now. Look how many years it's taken for somebody to consider it even has this kind of lasting value to whatever degree that it does, or that people are willing to believe that. So I'd start there with take
no
it down a notch. What's that?
No expectations. No,
well, lower expectations about what it's going to do for you, and higher expectations about how you can enjoy it, how you can explore it, and the joy that it can bring to you. That will enrich your life, but it's not going to be necessarily a way of paying the bills. And that's the reality. And that's probably always been the reality for artists, and probably will be. And no one should be embarrassed by that, but no one should go in thinking, well, if I just make this next great tape, this next great digital whatever, that's going to change everything. And yet, some things that we did and some things that you're going to do or have done have really changed the way we look at the world, and that the options that we have. Really, it's more about options and saying, this gives us another way. And so now look at all the options that you have. We're no longer burdened by too few channels, we're burdened by too many. and so, okay, how does that, there's a revolution to be fought there. And believe me, that plethora of channels, and you know this as well as I do, that's not really a lot of different ways of communicating. Just ask Comcast. They'd like to own most of them, and may very soon. But still, there are cracks in that armor always, and it's fun to look for those cracks, and it's fun to exploit those cracks. And sometimes what you do reverberates in ways that you didn't expect, and that's rewarding, and that's about all I can tell you.
There's another question. Yes.
Well, I have two questions, and maybe I'll ask the second one first, because it seems like just a continuation or way to keep probing at what you're saying. And a lot of the video collectives that came about around the time of Video Freaks, including Video Freaks, seem to have this ethos of like access to tools, like the kind of Whole Earth Catalog, this thing about access. And so now that access is so prevalent, you know, people can have a box, a lot of people, not everybody, has access to, a box in their pockets, and they can tell their stories through that. Like how has that changed? Because the idea was like access alone and tools can really kind of revolutionize media and be this tool for social change. And you know, how has the conversation changed now that people do have access, but maybe, as you said, there still aren't that many conversations. And the other thing is, up until he died at the end of 2013, I was kind of deep in conversation with Paul Ryan, who was part of Rain Dance. And I'm just wondering what the relationship was from your personal relationship between the various video collectives that were emerging at that time. Video Freaks and Rain Dance and Global Village and
some big stories. Access. What do we have access? We have access to apps now, which got us here tonight. You know, Google Maps.
Right,
didn't help me, unfortunately. I'd ask directions.
It sort of helped us. I'm still fascinated by the progress that the technology is making, you know, widescreen, high definition, streaming. It's not so much what we've got in the pocket, but then how to get stuff out. Also, constantly thinking about how to make a living doing this. I invented a way to make a living selling VHS tapes of products that I was making, and then it was DVDs, and now the VHS tapes stopped selling, the DVDs are no longer selling, and now I have to figure out how to sell things via streaming and pay-per-view, stuff like that. the technology, I don't think is the cameras, the hardware, isn't advancing as quickly as the delivery systems and the financial systems. The business is complex and daunting, actually. But it's so fun to see it happening. And we enjoyed all the other people. I never met a video person I didn't like. We may not have...
That's not
we may not have... Global Village... I didn't know what happened to those guys. But all the other groups, we may have been competitive. And
we were competing for money.
Yeah.
Endlessly competing for money.
But we did come together for Image Union, which was a wonderful project that a number of video groups came together for events, too. And actually, for May Day, there were a number of video groups, one of who's in the audience. Mm-hmm.
Road Art from Amherst is here tonight from the May Day Collective, who participated in documenting one of the most important actions in Washington, D.C. in 1971 to stop the war. They tried to shut down the government, essentially.
Speaking of shutting down the government, I just want us to remember, it's not just about the U.S., you know? Like, we live in the world, and I've been spending the last, 12 years, I guess, really trying to learn about and to promote community media around the world, which is really... I'm learning a lot, and there's a lot of projects that are really we all can learn from. And I was particularly struck this week by the dam boat sinking with 900 migrants, people knew that was a problem, and this was a project of Indie Media Maghreb. It's an Arab indie media out of Barcelona and also Morocco. And it's a map, and it's a lot of cell phone nodes, because a lot of migrants have cell phones, and it's places that before they cross the Straits of Gibraltar, they can go to a particular site and find out where the surveillance cameras are, and where the police are, and the police boats, and it's like an amazing project that was actually funded by Deep Dish TV. We got a grant to try to empower international media groups around the world, and we gave funds. It was a re-granting process, and we gave funds to South African indie media and this particular group that came out of Barcelona. But I just feel like they started out actually as a video collective, but they realized that what people really need were maps. So it's not limited to video anymore. Huh. Mm.
There's another question.
Interesting.
Hi. Thank you very much for everything tonight. I kind of have a last question. Which is, you know, you've talked a lot about how you got to Lanesville and why you left New York City, and I think that resonates with a few of us here, potentially. I just relocated from the city. But why did you leave Lanesville? Why did you decide to go, or did you go, or how did you go, and how did the community react to you leaving?
Well, in many senses, some of us, actually the three of us sitting here, didn't entirely leave, although we left Lanesville, we didn't leave the area. Carol and I were living already in a hamlet nearby in Phoenicia and commuting back and forth to Maple Tree Farm for a while, and then had to find ways to support our family, so I went off.
The grants ran out.
The grants ran out, and that happened. Bart, we can talk about moving to Woodstock with Nancy and Chuck, and they were working there. So a lot of people, and then other people went much further. Davidson was pretty much in the city, but other places, and David was in California for quite some time, and so the people were
People drifted away one at a time.
It wasn't all a one-time thing, and Anne also was in the city. And sometimes people would come and visit us, and they. So it was a gradual withdrawal, and it was just you grow and change.
But Bart lived in the house last.
Right.
So how did people in Lanesville react?
How did what?
Did anybody in Lanesville say anything to you about?
Oh, well, when we had to say goodbye to our landlords, the Ginsburgs, it was very sad. We found that we had an opportunity to move to the big city, Woodstock. And Woodstock had a cable station that was inactive. And so we took, what was left of our funding, and we actually continued to get State Arts Council grants for a number of years.
But they were smaller, weren't they?
They were diminishing.
Yeah.
And I was doing the final reports and interim reports and getting more complex all the time. And, you know, I would spend a month working for $2,000 at the end, you know. So we moved the media center to Woodstock, and it actually was a great place to wind up, because all of that we had learned about community and video and financing our work, we could take, we sort of jumped into a very hot community. We got a cable station, which meant the signal looked pretty good. We had our funding, we got an office, and people came every day. Every day there were people who wanted to produce programming. When we turned the cable on, we were overrun, really, with people who wanted to create. And so we did have some equipment, and there were other people in the community there who had equipment. And so we thrived for a number of years in Woodstock. I think I was on the board of directors of the Cable Access for 10 years there, and now I'm doing it in Saugerties, which is even a bigger town, but nobody wants to produce video there, and that's quite an interesting thing to me. The station kind of was born by some people who had money, and they made a college level video station studio, but nobody wants to use it, and I'm still trying to figure out why. It's like sitting there. It's like, you know, they say build it and they will come. But it has to be, what I realized is that it has to be organic. It has to sort of grow at a certain moment.
Well, it sounds like to me the future really is in low power FM, which is what's happening here at the Sanctuary. I wanted to end with a quote from a book that Carol mentioned before, the Spaghetti City Video Manual, which was a guidebook for port-a-packs that Perry primarily wrote. And what strikes me about this quote is how similar the goals of the Video Freaks were, and those concerns are today, 40 years later, 45 years later. So maybe I can ask Perry if you could read this.
It's been a long time. This is the same wonderful technology that brought you bombs guided by video cameras, wiretaps, and other forms of covert surveillance. It brings you broadcast TV and Muzak. It collects your money. It has your name, address, telephone number, and now your picture and voice. This technology has provided us with tools that are at the same time exciting and frightening. If we are to use these tools, it is essential that we understand their very nature.
Wow.
Thank you.
I finally finished reading that book this year.
Spaghetti City?
Yes. And I just
a lot of good
that's
do,
sort of at the end, right? That's at the last page or something. And I got there just a few weeks ago. It's very good.
Thank you, everyone.
Viva the Sanctuary for Independent Media.